So one thing I wanted to share with you is that we also are looking at innovative ways to find out about how people feel about what we teach them, what we show them, how can we change practice. So there's a real sentiment in the VA that supports me, the Veterans Administration, against these large conferences. And I think this is a wonderful thing. I've been involved for a decade, and it's a great honor to work with people like Elizabeth and the planning committee. I learned so much, and I enjoy seeing all of you every year. So one thing we did last year was that we used a technique that I used when I worked in behavioral medicine in measuring people's hand temperature. And you should know that when you're stressed, your hands get cold and clammy. That's the fight or flight response. So throughout the day, we got this feedback from you, and I wanted to show you those results. So last year, DSM-5 was released days before the conference. We're all excited, and we had a symposium on that. So we looked at how excited or emotional this was an experience for you. And so in what we found out was, while we got very great feedback, everybody loved it, or a lot of people said, why should we care about this? Hence the diversity among us. For psychologists, it's our bread and butter, but there wasn't that much of a change in hand temperature. The hand temperature didn't go down. You didn't get excited or stressed or anything like that. But there was a panel on antipsychotic use, and that provoked a lot of responses. People thought one speaker or the other speaker should have been given more time, and we struggled with this. How could we give more time? We thought about maybe a webinar, and then one of my more seasoned colleagues said, no, there's no way we can cover this in a webinar. And really, we all felt that we needed an expert to come and tell us about the behavioral management of behavioral disturbance in dementia patients. And that's why we have Ron Finley here today. But I wanted to give you guys some feedback on this. So we had this antipsychotic panel, and then we had a stress management presentation Dolores gave, Dolores Gallagher-Thompson, which was wonderful. She taught you relaxation exercises. And what you'll notice is that on the left, the white bars are before, right before the presentation, and you can see people's hand temperatures went down. It was a very robust effect. You feel, those of you who were here last year, feel very strongly about this. And that's really important to be aware of. It's a very emotional issue. There are a lot of ethical dilemmas people had. And so I launched an ethics feature in the Journal of Alzheimer's Disease. Please come submit articles to me about ethical issues around this topic. But also on the right, you'll notice that the before is the stress management. People were able to quiet themselves. Their hand temperature went up. So even in a large group, we can teach people ways to change their physiological arousal and take care of themselves. So I encourage those of you involved in dementia care to take care of yourselves and to use these relaxation exercises. So here's my ethics review in Journal of Alzheimer's Disease again. And I have to thank Kalameta and Dolores Gallagher-Thompson for doing that excellent work last year. So now I'm going to introduce Ron Finley. He's a recognized expert in geriatric drug therapy. His current clinical practice sites include the UCSF Memory and Aging Center and Sutter Health, Brain Health Center at the Davies campus, and Ron's previous practice sites include a clinic in Ethiopia. He's a visiting professor times two in Japan, and projects with the San Francisco Health Department. And he asks that you hold your questions. He'll be taking questions after his presentations, and we'll have volunteers roaming with microphones. We've allowed a lot of time for this presentation. I know you'll enjoy it. So,
thank you very much. That's my fan club out there. Mark Twain said that an expert is someone that borrows your watch to tell you the time. And that's what I'm going to do this afternoon. We have 90 minutes together. So if you haven't had your extra cup of coffee, you better run out and get it, because we're going to move through this fairly quickly in the beginning. And then for the question part, we're going to actually do cases. So the cases will be at the end. And these are cases that I have experience with. So all of these people I've known and been involved with. So we got a few things to cover before we get to that, the educational objectives, and I think we'll cover these. So I believe that if you're a caregiver and you're here to gain new information, you're going to get it in the next 90 minutes. If you're a healthcare professional, you're going to learn some new techniques and hopefully something about drug therapy related to treating psychiatric issues and dementia that you didn't know before. And hopefully you'll walk out of here not only with more positive attitude towards some drugs, but maybe a negative attitude regarding some medications also. So we'll cover the basic issues of the cholinesterase inhibitors. We'll talk about the second generation antipsychotics, and we'll talk about the different types of dementia, describe the role that drugs have in treating psychiatric issues related to a dementia. And we'll look at some of the side effects and some of the drug interactions. These are my disclosures. RX Consultant is a national drug therapy newsletter that I'm associate editor, have been for some years. HGA Healthcare Consultants is a private organization run by Dr. Groh, who I believe is here today. I've had the pleasure of working with Harriet for many years. Eldercare is another private group that I take consults from, and recently been doing a project with the city of San Francisco that hopefully will be translated into saving money for cities and improving drug therapy for those at risk, especially those that are getting home care. So outside of that, not too bad for a C-plus average, right? Okay, question I get most often is, how do I keep him or her asleep? And this, I think, is a pretty effective way. And it says, these pills will help you stay asleep. They change your dreams into PowerPoint presentations. And I've spoken at enough senior centers that actually I have results that I can prove that. So the first place we're going to start before we get to any kind of drug is, what type of dementia are we talking about? This is so basic and so key that I see this every day that it comes up. It's the dementia. Well, probably it's Alzheimer's, right? Roughly, what, 65%, somewhere in there, of dementias are Alzheimer's. It could be vascular. It could be a combination of AD and vascular. It could be frontal temporal dementia. It could be Pick's disease, Lewy body dementia, progressive supranuclear palsy, corticobasal degeneration, primary progressive aphasia, which can be divided now into three separate categories. If you graduated 20 years ago, you won't know what two-thirds of these are, right? Because we didn't know these diagnostic issues at that time. Huntington's disease, dementia associated with Parkinson's disease, and Creutzfeldt-Jakob, which is a prion disease. And that's related to mad cow disease. Those are both prion diseases. So I will be taking some water occasionally and may need a lozenge, because we've had some allergies in my area of Marin, and I think I'm allergic to all of them. So this is not a cold, it is an allergy. So we're going to look at these cases, but we'll come back to them later. I just want you to be thinking about them. So this is a 76-year-old male, retired physician, diagnosed with Alzheimer's about 4 years ago. Actually, I was there when he was assessed for the first time. He probably actually had AD for at least 2 or 3 years before that, but it wasn't recognized. He became agitated at times, and he was aggressive and physical, and he actually struck his wife at least twice that I know of. Particularly had problems at night. Sometimes would wake up in the night and become very, quote, agitated. Agitated can mean a lot of things. We're going to come back to that. In this case, he tried to break down his wife's bedroom door, right? So those are his conditions that he has, pretty benign. He was on Aricept, Donepezil, Simvastatin, Famotidine for GERD, gastrointestinal esophageal reflux disease, Citalopram, 10 milligrams daily in the morning, and a little acetaminophen. So remember that case. So the next step, once you've gotten to the point that you have a pretty good idea of what type of dementia you're dealing with, is to take a complete medication history, a complete, emphasis on complete medication history. So if you're a caregiver, this is very important for you to do when you go to your healthcare provider and each time to go over it with him or her. So obviously the prescription drugs. But often I find prescription drugs from optometrists, ophthalmologists, podiatrists, dentists are not included in that. So that's all prescription drugs, everything. Non-prescription, those are sometimes overlooked. They're real drugs. They can cause real problems. Alternative treatments, I deal a lot with this. Vitamins, nutritional supplements. I won't go into the whole nine yards about this, but my basic advice, I use Mark Twain a lot, who said, if you base your healthcare on what you read, be careful, you might die of a misprint. So there's a lot of misinformation and a lot of good information out there. But some of these are real drugs. Let me give you an example. Some of the commercial products now have huperzine, huperzine A, there's an A and a B, in them. And this is a cholinesterase inhibitor. It's a real drug. It does not have to be approved by the FDA. It's a nutritional supplement. It comes from Chinese club moss. So read the label. Take it to your pharmacist. Ask him or her. Take it to your doctor. Ask him or her. Is this something I should be taking? Social drugs, alcohol, nicotine, and caffeine. Usually we get alcohol, though I have to say that often with my neuro residents and fellows, I'll hear, never drink. And I'll say, never drink alcohol? You need to go back and check that. Because I've had patients who were drinking a fifth of vodka a day up until last week. Right, it's happened. And they stopped. So if you ask them that question, you get, I don't drink. Same with drugs. Immunizations, it's important to cover those. Drug allergies. If you're a clinician, it's very important to try to identify, is it probably a true allergy or is it a side effect of the medication? Because we may want to use it later. And what works and what doesn't? So I've had patients where pain is an issue, and we'll come back to that, and I've been told that Tylenol failed. When I ask them, they say, yeah, it helped a little bit for my joint pain. Well, how much did you use? 325. Acetaminophen two or three times a day. So the next step is, because generally that is a safe drug, is to increase the dose and give it a fair trial, because you've already had a preliminary trial, but not enough of it. And medication adherence. Are you actually taking or giving these medications? Or was a prescription actually filled? Sometimes I find that that's the case. It hasn't been filled. And so we think it was, but the truth is that medication is not on board. The next thing is to look at drugs that can impair cognition. And they're fairly common. The biggest ones I want you to remember are probably the benzodiazepines. That's the Valium-like drugs, the Ativan, your Xanax. And we're going to come back to those later. And alcohol. And getting the accurate amount of how much someone is taking, again, is sometimes difficult. But the anticholinergic drugs, you're going to see later in a few minutes a slide, that the anticholinergic drugs work directly against the cholinergic. That's your Aricept, your Exelon, your Razadine. So these drugs can't be very effective if they've got something that they're banging up against, essentially. And not so much the Tagamet, the Zantac, Pepcid. Those, there are case reports of confusion. But they're isolated. There were patients usually had severe renal and liver dysfunction, or there were excessive doses. But there are case reports. And sort of anecdotally, drugs like prednisone in high doses can cause mental status changes, both at the time they're given and later if they're withdrawn too quickly. So there are a lot of things out there to watch for. Okay, here's our other case to keep in mind. This is a younger gentleman, 59 years old, with a diagnosis of behavioral variant of frontal temporal dementia. How many people, I'm curious, how many people in the room have heard of frontal temporal dementia? Hold up your hand. Great. When I would give these presentations at UCLA in a program I helped chair, for about 15 years. About 10 years ago, primarily with physicians, I'd get maybe a third of the physicians would hold up their hands. Now I get the majority. And that's what's happening. In these areas, our ability to diagnose many of these conditions is far ahead as our ability to treat. And that's unfortunate, but that's just the way, that's the way it is right now. But it is important to know what type of dementia it might be. So this gentleman reports, or his wife reports, he's recently become more aggressive, but not assaultive, but more aggressive verbally. He's rather engrossed with his computer, spends a lot of time. He's impulsive, impulsive behavior. A lack of empathy is often one of the first things you see in FTD. They tend to be younger patients. Rarely do I see that in anyone in their 70s. If it is, it's usually the early 70s, and it's probably been there for a while, just not picked up. But he was employed as a chemical engineer. In fact, about 4 or 5 years before his diagnosis, he had put in their whole irrigation system in the house that he helped build. But he wouldn't be able to do that now. So he was started on donepezil, which is Aricept. He was started on Ativan, lorazepam, and PRN agitation. And those were started about a week ago. We'll come back to that case. Okay. So let's look at the patterns of behavioral psychiatric issues related to a dementia. And I find this helpful, and it's helpful when you're describing it as a caregiver. It's helpful if you're describing it to another healthcare provider, that we're talking about apples and apples and oranges and being specific as we can. So if we look at the four basic areas, depression, psychosis, agitation, and anxiety, those are pretty basic general areas. Cohen Mansfield, she's done a lot of work in the issues of assessing agitation. And in nursing homes and assisted living, I actually sometimes give the caregivers or the healthcare workers a little scale. She's got several different forms of her agitation scale to get a better idea of what we're talking about agitation, because that ranges from assaultive behavior, biting, scratching, hitting, to just can't sit still, right? Wide range. Agitation, if you come to me and say, Ron, Ms. Jones is having a lot of agitation, what's a good medication for that? That word agitation means nothing to me, right? So we go back to the beginning. Tell me exactly what's happening. Describe it. So that's very important, I think, for all of you here today, whether or not you're a caregiver, if you're a patient, if you're a healthcare worker. It's very important to define these issues. So let's break it down a little further. So aggression could be verbal. Could be physical. That's more obviously more problematic. It could be pacing, repetitive actions or movement. It could be apathy. It could be depression. Depression is very common to see in dementias of all kinds. It's also, unfortunately, after a couple of years of being a caregiver, common in caregivers. So depression is always something to be looking for. And it could have a flavor of mania. Some of these patients, if you look, occasionally I'll see that in the previous years, they actually have had some concern in the diagnostic area of maybe being bipolar. And that might affect which medication you would select. So psychosis, hallucinations, delusions. Hallucinations, are they bothersome? In Lewy body dementia, for example, hallucinations are one of the very early presentations that you see. People describe them in great detail and are not, I've never seen anyone alarmed by it. They're almost always visual, occasionally auditory, and I've had two cases, they were tactile. They could just see it and they could describe how it felt, which is very, very rare. But it's not disturbing. It's disturbing to their loved ones when they find out they're seeing little animals and people wandering around the ceiling. And actually, a couple times, it turned out not to be Lewy body, but excessive doses of amantadine. right? Sematril, yeah, twice. Very, very similar type of hallucinations. Same with delusions, misidentification, paranoia or suspiciousness, very common, especially in Alzheimer's disease. So in some of these areas, let's see if we have one more. No, let me go back. Some of these areas, we can begin to think about drug therapy, assaultive behavior, certainly depression, bothersome hallucinations. Patients that see monsters trying to claw their way through a wall to get away, I've seen that. It's got to be a terrible, terrible feeling. However, verbalization does not respond well to drug therapy. Wandering does not respond well to drug therapy. A lot of these areas that we can reduce that effect, we can make it go away temporarily, but we're basically going to put the person in a state of sedation. And I've actually seen that a few times, where the patient in the daycare program, after the wandering was reported and he was treated, was brought in on a gurney because he was prescribed risperidone and Ativan, both at the same time. So there's areas that we can say, sure, we can think about a medication here, but then some that we need to back off and say, no, that's probably not the best way to approach this. I would say, and I'm just guessing now, I see a lot of patients. I see and probably assess each week maybe 100 patients, 150 a week. I do probably at least 6 or 7, sometimes 10 or 12, detailed consultations based on the medical history. Sometimes I'm meeting with the patient per week. Of all of those, where there's a behavioral problem, my impression is, in my experience, that about 40 to 50% of those problems can be managed with appropriate non-drug therapy. Non-drug therapy. So don't clap yet. It's not easy. So I say sometimes to groups, what we need is not more new drugs, but more new social workers who are therapists, neuropsychologists, and people in those areas, and people to train, as you're doing on the Alzheimer's Association, to train the caregivers and managers at home how to deal with these issues. So this is so important, but it's often, I think, underfinanced. So I know I'm speaking to the choir here, but I wanted to say that because I do believe that rather strongly. So let's look at what do we do here. We document the behavior. Exactly what happened. I get a call. She hit someone in the nursing home. We need a drug. I talk to the people there. She didn't hit, because I've known this person for a long time. She could have. No, but she pushed away. When did it happen? It happened at bathing time, right? This sound familiar? Then I talked to the CNA or LVN who was there, and her comment was, I told the other girl she shouldn't shout at her. I said, you're right. Then I talked to the director of nursing. So they needed some more training. So that actually happened. So document the behavior, what actually happened. Is behavior precipitated by an event? A gentleman was put on Haldol, unfortunately, because he was very aggressive and belligerent at luncheon in a daycare program. This happened. And wound up, frankly, in the hospital. He had a bad reaction to the Haldol because they started him on Cogentin at the same time, which is a no-no. And as it turned out, there were some at the table he didn't get along with, and they asked me my advice. And I said, I think you need a better maitre d'. You don't need another drug. And in fact, they did that, and he didn't require a drug. So determine if behavior poses a hazard. That's obviously important. Assess behavior for possible non-drug therapy. Is behavior amenable to drug therapy? Is this a reasonable approach? Do we have any evidence? And I'm a big believer, if I recommend something, if I were called to court to prove it, I have evidence that I can back it up with. And I say that having been an expert witness a number of times. And I tell my medical residents and psychiatrists and fellows in neurology, the same thing. Heard on the street, heard in the hall is not good enough. Determine pros and cons. You always look at the issues. There's always side effects. Select the least hazardous drug. So is an antipsychotic a good drug for sleep? Not just if it's simple insomnia. No. Because that's a fairly hazardous drug and should be used selectively. Set goals and monitoring parameters and guidelines. So what do you expect to happen? When do you expect it to happen? And as I tell families with medications, like even the antipsychotics, that the full benefit is not going to happen right away. And it may take a few days. So don't expect that you're going to see an instant change in the behavior. So I just mentioned this. You may be familiar with this, but I like Cohen Mansfield and her work. The NPI is a neuropsychiatric inventory. It's used in research, but also can be useful. There's a nursing home version of it. And Behave AD, I'm familiar with it only in research projects. So we have a lot of drugs that we could select from to treat a behavioral, general, quote, behavioral issue. A lot of drugs. And the issue becomes, which ones do we select? Well, I'll tell you up front, the best evidence is really with the cholinesterase inhibitors, to some degree antipsychotics, and the antidepressants. So those are the three, depending on the behavior that I'm looking at first. Beta blockers like propranolol were used some years ago, but have never shown clinically to be that effective and have some side effects. And I've often said that, yeah, they would work if someone has an Alzheimer's type of dementia and they're too active, and you get their heart rate down to 36, they're not going to be active anymore. But that's not a good idea, and we don't want to do that. So we don't use those. Okay, so let's go to some drugs that you're familiar with, the cholinesterase inhibitors. These are the ones, and I'll make just a few comments here, that Tacrin's, of course, long gone, but Aricept, Donepezil, Exelon, Razadine are the ones that we have. In my own opinion, in Alzheimer's disease, I don't believe there's one that's better than another. Sometimes individuals will tolerate one better than another, but therapeutically, I think they're comparable. You see maybe about in AD, about a third of the patients, I think you can see a response that you can identify fairly readily. About another third of them will stabilize. They don't decline as rapidly, and that's difficult to pick up sometimes in the community. And about a third of them don't respond, period. It's very different in Lewy body. Patients with Lewy body dementia tend to respond fairly robustly right within the first week sometimes. It's a very, very big difference. I'll talk a little bit more about doses in a few minutes. The side effects, obviously the nausea, the cholinesterase inhibitors. So you're trying to, and are increasing the acetylcholine in the system by blocking the destruction of acetylcholine. And there's some side effects just naturally occurring pharmacologically when a drug does that. Nausea is one of them. Increased urination could be one of them, diarrhea. So when I run into that, and I'm sometimes referred to these patients by my medical colleagues, my approach is to reduce the dose by 50%. So you're starting at 5, you go to 2.5. If the problem still exists, is to divide the dose morning and afternoon. And many times, the problematic area is really the diarrhea, in my experience. And many times by doing that, this is not FDA approved, by the way, by doing that, you can reduce that side effect. But some people won't tolerate one, and then we'll try another one. Disturbing dreams, that occurs more often, I think, with Aricept. I like to give it in the morning, even though the package insert says give it in the evening. That was a thought that if you had gastrointestinal disturbances, you would sleep through it. I don't think I ever have, but maybe some people do. But the dreams happen in about 12-15% of cases. And they're not always disturbing. They awaken the individual sometimes, and I've had people describe them to me and say, you know, it was really great. I met this, I said, that's enough. I don't need to know more. It's okay. You enjoyed it, wonderful. But sometimes they are disturbing, and the individual can't get back to sleep. So the first thing I look for, the sleep problems, is when do they give the cholinesterase inhibitor? appears to appear less frequently with Razadine and Exelon. Muscle cramps can occur. Syncope, fainting, so patients have to have good cardiac function. If their heart rate is slow, they need to reach to a consult with a cardiologist. So by slow, I mean usually below 60 beats per minute. Hypomania. How many people here know these drugs can cause hypomania? Hold up your hand. Not many. I wouldn't expect many. Usually it happens late in Alzheimer's. These are Alzheimer's patients almost always. And the person now becomes much more agitated and active than they were before. They've been very sedentary before this time. And in that case, we just stop the drug. Occasionally, you get hints of it early in therapy when it's first started. And then we'll try to continue it, and usually do. So it's not that common. Weight loss is fairly common. And surgical issues, the interaction is with certain skeletal muscle relaxants, like succinylcholine. They're used mostly for cardiac surgery, some abdominal surgery. And the Aricept kinds of drugs, all of them, Exelon, Razadine, they interact with those muscle relaxants to greatly magnify that effect. And you can have effective paralysis of the pulmonary muscles. They stop breathing. I've known two cases. Both survived. But the anesthesiologist was a little surprised. So something to think about. If you're going in to see or knowing someone's going to surgery, is you check and see what kind of surgery and which medications should be discontinued prior to the surgery and how long. So hypersensitivity, I've never seen that, but you could be allergic to these drugs. Cardiac conduction problems are an issue. Lewy body patients tend to have hearts that are more sensitive to these drugs. We wrote a paper on that a few years ago. So we're more cautious in those patients. I'm cautious with like the Aricept 23 milligram, which is sustained release, and you see more gastrointestinal problems, you see more fainting with it. I frankly, my opinion, it should not be on the market. I've seen too many problems with it. So there's no reason to have a long-acting form of Aricept because inherently the drug is long-acting, has a long half-life. It's a once-a-day drug. So severe renal or hepatic has to be very, very severe. So I've never have come across that as an issue. So going back to the interactions, these are the ones if you're getting a prescription filled, you're a caregiver, or if you're the patient, is ask the pharmacist, do any of these medications that I'm on, are they going to blunt the effect of this drug? This won't come up as a drug-drug interaction in most programs that pharmacies are using. So these are all drugs that have anticholinergic. Diphenhydramine is Benadryl, and I've seen actually two cases of individuals in their well into their 80s were diagnosed with MCI, and they were taking two or three Benadryl a day, mostly for sleep. We got them off of those, and 3 months retested them. They tested within the normal range. So you always want to pick up those drugs when you can. Elevil's amitriptyline, that's always on my hit list for my Alzheimer's patients especially. And this is a whole list of another ones. Hydroxyzine is Vistaril. Cetirizine, Zyrtec is over-the-counter antihistamine, is the active ingredient in hydroxyzine. That actually has very, very little anticholinergic activity, and I think is okay. Paxil is paroxetine. Paroxetine is often overlooked by clinicians as having anticholinergic activity. In fact, in vitro, in test tubes, it has more anticholinergic activity than nortriptyline, which is a tricyclic antidepressant. So a careful review, Xanaflex is a skeletal muscle relaxant that's very anticholinergic. So optimizing the drug therapy, don't expect immediate response from the cholinesterase inhibitors. Important to counsel families, patients on this. These drugs can take up to several months to see the full benefit. It may or may not be memory. When I talk to medical groups, if you're all just physicians, the first words out of my mouth was, if you're looking just for an improvement in memory on the cholinesterase inhibitors, you're going to miss how they work. The first thing that they probably do is a reduction in apathy. People are more involved in their environment, which is all good. And memory sometimes does improve, but not always. At least a 6-month trial, then consider Do you want to add memantine? We'll touch on memantine in a minute. And are you doing it? Stop the drug now. Usually I like to taper off all these drugs if you can, but sometimes we just stop them if they're having a bad reaction. And we do titrate, when I say we, my practices and clinics, titrate to the full maximum 10 milligram dose in Alzheimer's, sometimes in Lewy body. These drugs are not approved for Lewy body dementia. We will go up higher, and probably we go, sometimes I've seen patients in the low 20s, slowly over a period of several months. May take. And some patients will respond actually at that higher dose, especially for Lewy body, unusual in Alzheimer's. Okay, I think I've covered most of this. There is pretty good evidence that the cholinesterase inhibitors reduce the need later on for psychoactive drugs. Yeah. There's a number of studies that have looked at that. Reduction in caregiver time, there is really pretty good evidence for that. But they're not wonder drugs. They're not the drugs we would like, obviously. So the reduction in apathy improves social awareness, interaction, and sometimes improvement in activities. Okay? So I think these are worthwhile drugs. Not everyone agrees. There's a lot of pros and cons. They have some side effects. They can be troublesome. The one probably the most problematic is urinary output that I see. My patients that often have urinary incontinence or issues, either just below the surface or they're there. They can be expensive, but mostly are covered by healthcare costs now, various kinds. And they add to the number one more medication that you have to remember to give. So I tell all of my practitioners, I want you to review that medication list every time you see that patient, and I want you to justify every drug that's on there. If you can't, you need to think about discontinuing it. Every time you see that patient. I just reviewed a psychiatric case with UCLA last week. And there was a drug on there that someone else had added, but the psychiatrist managing the patient said, well, I thought I would just leave it. And I said, what good is it doing? Well, it's not doing any harm. I said, well, it could. So unless you can justify that drug, I would strongly suggest that you discontinue it. And what would happen if I don't? You could have a lawsuit. There's some serious drug interactions with that drug that resulted in fatalities. And if I'm the expert witness on the other side, you don't want to see me. And they, I think, did DC it. Okay. Memantine, let me just go back. Yeah. Okay, memantine is an older drug. It's been around since the 1960s. Eli Lilly in the United States worked with it, I think, for diabetic peripheral neuropathies. It failed. It's failed in a lot of areas. Migrated to Europe, was used like a folk medicine, really, for a number of years. And then Lundbeck picked it up, did a study in dementia patients, very assorted group, all kinds of things going on there. But they suspected some benefit, and later they did some better studies. And finally got approved in the United States by a study in New England Journal of Medicine by Riceberg et al. So my take on memantine is, as a single agent, it's not very good, frankly, right up front. It hasn't worked in Alzheimer's patients that have mild dementia. It's approved for moderate to severe. And in some studies, it has not been positive in all domains, in some studies, in some domains. However, I think we do have patients occasionally for cardiac reasons cannot use the cholinesterase inhibitors. So in those instances, you don't really have much of a choice. And it's worthwhile, I think, for a try. That's sort of my take on it. If someone is stabilized on a cholinesterase inhibitor and they have moderate to severe Alzheimer's disease, especially in the moderate range, because I know not well, but one of the researchers that did some of the work on this drug, and he admitted to me that most of the positive responses were in the moderate group. So if you're a clinician, when you get that, look at that study, it puts moderate and severe almost always together in that category. And you can't, it's almost impossible to separate it out. And that's too bad. So I would say in that, then we think about adding it after someone is on a full dose of one of your cholinesterase inhibitors and monitor it for improvement, see if there's no benefit in 6 months, think about discontinuing it, okay? It's a pretty benign drug. I was chaired two safety committees on studies that use memantine. In one of the studies, we saw some serious potentially adverse reactions. And as the chair of the safety committee, they broke the code for me. The researchers didn't know. All the severe reactions were in the placebo group. Yeah, not memantine. So placebos have side effects, folks. They do. All drugs have side effects. So I think there's a modest role here. It should not, in my experience, be used in frontal temporal dementia. It's failed in those studies. If you're a clinician, in animals, it protected the tau protein from hyperphosphorylation. So we know amyloid and tau involved in dementias, we think. But in fact, it was of no benefit in FTD. Lewy-bodied patients may get worse on this medication. Multiple sclerosis patients should not receive it because a study was stopped because of adverse effects, which did surprise me, related to memantine. So Namenda is the brand name. Very few drug interactions. If you alter the urinary pH, it can affect the excretion rate. That's unusual. It's possible. But going back, so we're looking at the underlying cause, the deficiency, optimize the treatment of the dementia. So if it's Alzheimer's, we're going to optimize the cholinesterase inhibitors. We may add memantine. If it's one of the others, Lewy body, we're certainly going to maximize the cholinesterase inhibitors, but not add memantine. And in FTD, we're not going to use either of that class of medications. Okay. I don't experience any of the side effects listed in the enclosed literature. Should I be concerned? So for caregivers and physicians, too, and nurses, they're seeing patients, that, in fact, when the pharmacy gives out this sheet of possible side effects, very often, there's no determination as which are severe, which are common. And sometimes the side effects would only occur if they took the whole bottle, frankly. So I ask pharmacists when I do pharmacy programs to circle the four or five most common side effects and explain that irregular heartbeat is probably only going to be related to very high doses of this medication. But I do know and have seen of patients that stopped or didn't, again, take the medication because of that. All right, now we're going to talk about some of the drugs. How are we doing time-wise? Is anyone timing me? Because I'll go till dinner time, folks. You know, okay, I think we're doing okay. And the scariest is usually antipsychotics. They probably shouldn't be, but that's often the case. So we have the older ones. Haldol is a typical antipsychotic, first generation. And we have the second generation, and I'm going to just run through these and make a few comments. Haldol in some studies in Alzheimer's patients, dementia patients, these had Alzheimer's, there was a greater risk of death than with the second generation. Some people dispute that. We can go back and forth. But it was a pretty good study. It may have been because they were very seriously delirious or agitated and required IV Haldol, which they do use sometimes, in excessive amounts. And in large amounts, you can increase the what's called the QTC interval, which can increase the risk for ventricular tachycardias and death, certain types. So we'll touch on that again in a minute. So Clozaril, Clozapine, I almost never, ever see that used in my elderly patients. Risperidone, Risperdal, in Alzheimer's patients has the best evidence, three large studies. It's approved in the UK for a behavior that may be, how do they phrase it, behavior that may be dangerous to caregivers or to patients. That's a restriction, that have a dementia. But it is approved. Not approved. None of these are approved here. So Risperdal has the best evidence, and it probably has the most typical side effects, like the Parkinsonism, the stiffness, the tremor, things of that type. Okay with it. Usual dose that's effective is right around 1 milligram. We'll start at 0.25, one in the morning, one in the evening. If they respond, we'll consolidate it to 0.5 at bedtime. If they don't respond, we'll increase it by 0.5 every few days to a maximum of 1 to 1.5 milligrams. Reason I know that, because I just did it, right, just a few days ago. in a patient that was very agitated, was somewhat assaultive, hitting at people, couldn't get in a hospital situation, was problematic to treat her, got her off of all the other medications that she was on, that she really didn't need, got her on an adequate dose of Risperdal. In 2 or 3 days, she was able to be transferred to a skilled nursing facility. Olanzapine, Zyprexa, my bias, that's my least effective or least liked antipsychotic. Olanzapine generally is not shown to be effective in treating behaviors related to Alzheimer's disease. In Lewy body patients and Parkinson's patients, it may worsen their gait, and it's not generally recommended by some PD organizations for that reason. The weight gain is another issue, and there are cardiovascular possible cholesterol issues and so on, but by and large, it's anticholinergic. The company will deny that, but there's an in vivo study, it means in the body, that is about one-fifth the anticholinergic activity of clozaril, which is very anticholinergic. So it's not one that I generally like to see, but if I have a patient that has a history of bipolar disorder and they've been well maintained on it, and now they have a dementia, because I think there is good evidence in bipolar disorders for Zyprexa, then I'm going to be very reluctant to recommend discontinuing it or change it. Seroquel, quetiapine, if you will, is the less potent antipsychotic. We look at that and the effect on a receptor called dopamine, and the dopamine is one of the ones that's involved in reducing assaultiveness, aggression, hallucinations, and so on. So it binds to that receptor, but it releases quickly, whereas risperidone binds and it stays there for much longer time, and whereas Haldol binds there and doesn't want to go away. So that gives you an idea. When you look at drugs and the receptors, you can begin to get an idea, at least I can, of what some of the side effects are going to be. So Seroquel is very sedating, has minor, moderate anticholinergic activity. And we do use it, especially in our patients at Parkinson's and Lewy body, because it's less likely to cause that Parkinsonism that you see with Risperdal. But just in the AD patient, the Alzheimer's patient, best evidence, 3 studies, each about 300 each, they used. And they found, quote, it was effective, at least by the p-value. It was statistically significant. Statistics don't always transfer to clinics, but it's a place to start. Geodon, ziprasidone is not used very much. It has more potential cardiac issues. I don't know how real they are. But it's an interesting drug, and it's both an antipsychotic and has antidepressant properties. But I see Geodon used very little. Aripiprazole, Abilify, I see that used. There's a couple studies, one in particular, that showed that it was effective. I don't tend to recommend it because it causes more akathisia. That's the restlessness that you see. So the first thing when I hear about, gee, she can't sit still. Gee, he's on the move all the time. Am I looking at a drug that actually is a side effect causes that? And sometimes that's the case. Other antipsychotics can, but Abilify seems to be a bit worse. Paliperidone is another drug that's actually the active ingredient that's in risperidone. And the newer ones, iloperidone, acendapine, and lurasidone, Latuda, I think is a brand name. I'm not aware of any evidence to use those drugs in patients with Alzheimer's, any, and maybe case reports somewhere. So I usually am not too happy about recommend. In fact, I don't recommend drugs. I don't have some evidence to support that. So let's see. Where are we here? Okay. So when we're selecting an antipsychotic, which antipsychotic can increase serum lipids, affect diabetes, weight gain, and those tend to be the ones like the Zyprexa, olanzapine. Cardiac issues, QT interval, something we watch if it gets too long and too high, usually over about 470, 500 milliseconds, there's a risk for ventricular tachycardia. Doesn't mean that will happen, but there is a risk. So the one that's more commonly implicated is the Geodon, but actually Seroquel has a fairly high QTC interval too. Risperidone tends to be a little lower. Risk for Parkinsonism, akathisia, tardive dyskinesia. So tardive dyskinesia, that is a benefit of the newer ones, and that it's far, far less common. It's been reported in Risperdal. I think it's been reported maybe in olanzapine in a few cases, questionable with quetiapine. So tardive dyskinesia was very common back. I've been doing this for a while, and I have seen a lot of cases of tardive dyskinesia. But it was the Thorazine, Haldol kinds of drugs were the big offenders for that. So it's rare to see it with the newer drugs. Falls are always an issue. All these drugs increase the risk for falls, almost every drug we're going to talk about. Some of them actually can impair cognition to some degree. And pulmonary aspiration, pneumonia, occurs with any of the antipsychotics. And last but not least, the most problematic side effect is death. And we're going to touch on that in a minute. We don't like to use that word very often in healthcare, but it's important. What are the risks and what are the benefits? So here's the basic, I think Dr. Lyonsworth presented some of this to you last session that you had. And I think I pretty much agree with her numbers. This is stroke, risperidone, and placebo, so about 2% increase in cardiovascular events. The other risk of death in general is about 1%. But there are some complicating factors here, and I threw this in as a second opinion. The use of antipsychotic medications, both conventional and atypical, was not associated with either time to nursing home admission or time to death after adjustment, et cetera, et cetera. So that's fairly recent, 2013. Another opinion, neither atypical nor conventional antipsychotics increase mortality, hospital admissions among elderly patients with dementia, a 2-year study, and that was a little earlier in 2007. But the use of restraints doubled the risk for mortality. Doubled the risk for mortality. So we forget about that. We don't see restraints probably used that much. Although I just had an occasion of patient, inpatient, that they used at least some restraints. That was the one I mentioned that we started on the risperidone and we were able to remove those. So let's go to that. That's sort of my gist on the antipsychotics. The antidepressants, and we'll go through these fairly quickly. The older ones, don't see much use of those. Amitriptyline is Elavil. I'd really like to avoid that. Nortriptyline I see used once in a while. The others, almost never. The monoamine oxidase inhibitors, almost never used anymore except in psychiatry. The two drugs that I usually don't recommend, the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, are paroxetine, Paxil, and fluoxetine, Prozac. Again, if I have someone and I see this that's doing well on that drug, I'm reluctant to change it or suggest changing it. So usually, obviously, I'm just consulting. But in fact, there are many more drug interactions, and I'll point out a couple to you in a few minutes. So the ones we use most commonly are Celexa, citalopram, and escitalopram, which is actually the active part of Celexa. Celexa is divided in the liver to a bunch of other chemical combinations, most of them inactive, but the active part is really escitalopram. So that's the Lexapro. So 10 milligrams of citalopram, 10 milligrams of escitalopram is equal to 20 to 30 milligrams of Celexa. Okay? So Wellbutrin, bupropion we use occasionally. Sometimes we'll add it into the other antidepressants if someone's been on one of these for a while. The SSRIs, they tend to build up what we call tachyphylaxis. That means that it worked 2, 3, 4 years ago, but now they're not so good. They're kind of remitting back into depression. So you have some choices. You can change antidepressants. You can increase or lower the dose. But very often, psychiatrists and practitioners will add a mild stimulant like bupropion. Years ago, it would have been Ritalin. Don't see that much used anymore. Mirtazapine or Remeron is also an effective medication for sleep in small doses, 7.5 to 15 milligrams. You get to 30 and above, you begin to lose some of that sedative, those sedative properties. And the venlafaxine, duloxetine, Effexor, Cymbalta are effective in depression, but also in pain management. So that's an important duo. Some studies, actually, the Effexor was a little more effective in depression than the Cymbalta. Trazodone usually we use for sleep, and the other two, nifazodone's only on the market. I think it's a generic now. And villazodone, even I'm having trouble with some of these names now. Don't really have Vibrid, I think, is a brand name. Really experienced with that. Okay. This is an important lesson to take away. These drugs are not just antidepressants. They're anti-anxiety drugs. They're effective in obsessive-compulsive behavior. They can reduce the number of panic attacks. And they can be used effectively to treat many of the behavioral issues that I've been talking about and that you see. So most of the work has been done with citalopram. This is a study that was just published in 2014 in, I think, JAMA, the Journal of the American Medical Association. There are others that have been published. Pollock et al., I think it's in your reference list that I gave you, compared it to risperidone, the antipsychotic. It was equally effective in managing behavioral issues in Alzheimer's patients. And another study compared it to another antipsychotic, perphenazine. It was as effective as the antipsychotic. So these are good drugs, I think, to start with, especially probably citalopram or maybe the Lexapro, escitalopram, in the beginning before you even begin thinking about antipsychotic agents. So I'm only going to touch on a couple of the drug interactions here because the ones I want to mention are that are missed. The NSAIDs are drugs like ibuprofen, naproxen, and that's because and this is true for all the SSRIs. They affect the platelets, the platelet aggregation, so they increase the risk for bleeding. So they're not bleed anticoagulants, they're not blood thinners as that such, but they increase the risk for gastric and bleeding ulcers in patients on your Motrin, your NSAID type of drug. The other is the tamoxifen, and this is an important drug interaction, is that tamoxifen is transformed in the liver to the active drug. Codeine is transformed in the liver to morphine. That's the active drug. Especially Paxil, paroxetine, reduces or interrupts that transmission. And in one follow-up study, actually two women post-breast cancer, there were more, and they were on tamoxifen, there were more women that had recurrence of the breast cancer that were on the tamoxifen and Paxil together. So those are some serious drug-drug interactions. The newer one, and this is pretty much hot off the press. This drug is probably not even in your pharmacies yet. It came up at a meeting in October that I attended. And bortioxetine, Brintellix, yes, is a brand name. Brintellix. The interesting thing about that, now it's an antidepressant, but in a small study that had elderly individuals, the average age of 71, it actually improved cognition above and beyond what you would expect in treating depression because they also had a group of elderly individuals that received an antidepressant of a different type and they responded to that. But on the testing, their tests were not as robust as the ones on this drug. So this drug actually, besides the serotonin issue, also has an effect on glutamate, which is a hot topic right now in psychiatry. May actually boost acetylcholine in the brain, and that's related to a serotonin activity, and probably has anti-emetic activity too, because it blocks the 5-HT3A, and that's your ondansetron type of effect. And so Remeron actually does that also, can be used, not approved for nausea and vomiting, but I've used it in patients, usually were cancer patients, they had anxiety, depression, and some nausea, and so we'd use that they could take every day. So I think this is an interesting drug to watch for. I think my approach is to wait till there are better studies, especially in elders, and it's expensive. The 5 milligram, which is a starting dose, is right now a month's supply is about $325. So that's not unusual. A lot of these drugs, if you went and bought them, even the generic, are very expensive. So when you select an antidepressant, we're looking to limit the drug interactions. We prefer not to have anticholinergic activity in our dementia patients. We can use something that is effective in several domains, not just one. And we should know which ones we would rarely prescribe for our older adults. This is an issue, the QTC issue with Celexa. I just want to mention it. FDA a couple years ago suggested very strongly, in fact, they said that the maximum dose in the elderly was to be those compromised, we had cardiac issues. What do we have there? No, I have to have more than 15 minutes. I go to 1:30. No, we're going to end before then. So this is something to be aware of. I don't think clinically it's usually an issue, but in fact your physician, if they write a prescription for Celexa or one of these medications, that you're on other drugs that can affect the QT, and there are literally hundreds that do. The pharmacy is going to call the physician, is going to delay the time that you're able to pick up or get your prescription. So that delay is not because they're putting you off, but now they have to go through a few more hoops to get it. I'm going to touch on Depakote, Valproate, and it's very simple. There's no good evidence to support the use of Depakote in patients that have Alzheimer's disease and psychiatric behavioral issues. There's just not. It is used, I know, and I see it. I think it's because of the sedative effect, and I usually argue against it as an unnecessary drug. So this was one of the issues, I think, that is sort of a pivotal issue, is a study done in Arizona over 3 years, because it was thought that Depakote would be protective of the neurons in the brain. It turned out to be exactly the opposite. In 3 years, those patients that had Alzheimer's that were on the Depakote had more brain loss. And I know about you, but at 78, I want to keep what I've got. So I'm negative about that medication for that reason. Again, if there's a bipolar issue, if it's for migraine headaches or for some of the other uses, fine. But not to treat my patients for a behavioral issue related to a dementia. And then concluded that another aspect of that study that was associated with significant toxic effects. Okay? Probably you haven't seen that before, have you? No. So sometimes, in a way, I think it's important to be hard on drugs that sort of deserve that. So the benzodiazepines are drugs that can be used for many different things. The side effects: impaired psychomotor skills, falls, driving, impaired memory, withdrawal syndromes, and additive to other CNS depressants. The bottom line is these drugs are used way, way, way too much in patients with dementias. They're used way, way too high a dose. And equivalent doses, Ativan is equal to 5 to 10 milligrams of Valium. It is not a low-potency drug. It is not short-acting. It is absolutely not safer in the elderly, across the board. My benchmark was a patient discharged from the hospital that I consulted on last year. It was on the equivalent of 120 milligrams of Valium. Yep. She was on both Ativan and clonazepam. So when you figured it out as Valium, that's how I always present it to physicians, is here's how much equivalent of Valium. They understand that. They understand that. So I'm sure in this group that's not an issue. But in the community, it's a huge issue. And I think other speakers have addressed that in the past. So you can't just stop these drugs. They need to be tapered off, worst case scenario. And I know this patient, the practitioner chopped the dose of Ativan at about 4 milligrams a day in half, and the patient resulted in a catatonic reaction, extremely rare. Usually you see increased agitation, nightmares, perspiration, and so on. So the most recent thing is that actually hypnotics were shown and sedatives to be an increased risk factor for mortality. These are the other agents that we don't see used very much, but I always look for alcohol because sometimes individuals will treat themselves. Sleep medications in my practices, in my clinics, we're not very fond of the Z drugs. We're more likely to use trazodone. We limit the number of benzodiazepines. Carl Salzman at Harvard, who's been practicing 47 years, I believe, did a small study of taking patients off benzodiazepines. These are elderly patients that don't have a dementia. Off benzodiazepines, and their cognition improved across the board. So now we're going to spend our last 30 minutes, because I get an extra 5 minutes because someone took 5 minutes of my time in the beginning. Memory's still pretty good, folks. the Scottish Irish never forget. Of course, there is Irish Alzheimer's, you know. You forget everything but your grudges. I think there's truth in that. I believe there's truth in that. I really do. Okay, let's go this. RT is an 85-year-old female, retired teacher, diagnosed with AD 5 years ago, residing in an assisted living facility for the past 6 months, and I did see this patient. I've changed a few things so you can't identify her. Staff report, she did bite and previously hit and was very agitated, so on and so forth. She's on Aricept, 10 milligrams in the PM, simvastatin, famotidine, Pepcid, Lexapro, 20 milligrams daily in the PM, acetaminophen, 4 times a day, 500 milligrams. Memantine, twice a day, aripiprazole, 10 milligrams, it's there. 10 milligrams twice a day, Seroquel, 25 twice a day, 50 milligrams at bed, at bedtime. Depakote, Ativan, 1 milligram every 4 hours as needed for agitation. So I look at the medication administration record, and it's given 2 to 3 times a day, almost every day, every day. Senna, melatonin at bedtime, vitamin D. So this is their behavioral problems here. She's having problems. The staff is having problems. So where do you begin to reduce the behavioral problems? Where do you start? You reduce the amount of contact she has with the staff. It's very fundamental. I don't want anyone pushing a pill at me 5 times, 10 times a day, right? So that's where I started. Consolidated some of the medications, began to taper off, excuse me, the antipsychotics. We kept the Depakote on to the last because the physician said he wanted to do that. And I said, fine. We scheduled the doses so some of them could be given once. I basically got her through most of the medications in the morning and the evening. Got pretty much everything out of the afternoon. Tapered her off, gave the donepezil in the morning. Didn't really need, we're way past cholesterol control. Got rid of the simvastatin. We increased actually the acetaminophen because she did have issues of a history of osteoarthritis and she had had some relief. And we stopped the, tapered the memantine off, reduced the aripiprazole to once a day, and then finally discontinued that. We gave the quetiapine in the morning and at bedtime and reduced the dose initially of the trazodone. Cut the lorazepam, the Ativan, in half and limited the number of times it could be given during the day. And it took a melatonin, wasn't doing any good, we got rid of that. Looked to see if constipation was an issue. I had a patient the other day that hadn't had a bowel movement in 10 days. Yeah, I mean, this is true. I've had 2 patients in hospice that were impacted. So I do, as a pharmacist, because I want to know if the drugs are working, if they're there, I do my own history, right? I do my own assessment. And then I turn to the nurses and say, take care of this. And they do, so, because they're terrific. This is the beginning of nursing week, right? Right, it is, this week, right. Often are doing the tough jobs, right. So this took about a month. So these things are not gonna happen right away. I met in the facility with the physician and the family and the nursing staff and the director of nursing, and it was a good group, it was a good group. Actually, I got a call about 2 weeks later. She was doing very well, but she woke up during the night and there was a little agitation. Should we add one of the antipsychotics back? I said, nope, there's going to be bumps in the road. This was from the family, you know. And so they stayed the course, and that was 2 months ago. I haven't heard from them since, which is good. Good news in my area. So this is a lady that involves dementia. She's a 91-year-old. She was in a very nice nursing home. In Northern California. She was combative, she bit, she scratched, she was not a happy camper. She was agitated at dusk per nursing notes. She did with a CNA. She did bite a nurse, attempted to give her medications. A dementia, probably 10 or 12 years out, listed depression, had a hospitalization, that's a clue. hospitalization for depression, so serious. Diagnosed, the main issue that I was confronted with is, this lady is sundowning. What's a good drug for sundowning? And my answer to that is, there are no good drugs for sundowning. It is not a diagnosis. It is a collection of symptoms. It's a syndrome. I went into this facility at sundown on a winter's day. And I won't do the whole nine yards, but I'll tell you the quick take. Black and white TV playing a World War II movie. Wind blowing, moving the drapes around the room, and as the sun was setting, I had a revolving light show going on. I could hear the bombs and the mortars going off down the hallway from the movie. And when I got there, she's on the bed, totally zonked. So I asked one of the nurses, I said, it's almost dinner time, and it looks like, she's asleep. Oh, Professor Finley. She got so agitated, we had to give her the Ativan. Right. Okay. So we've got one ID. We've ID'd one problem, right? And I haven't even looked at the MAR. I haven't looked at the chart. So we go through her medications, and she was on quite a list. So again, I started with, what can we get rid of? A lot of the things on there are issues that someone resolved some time ago. Vitamin C is not going to prevent urinary tract infections. Could stop that right off the bat. Artificial tears, one drop, didn't seem to be a real reason for that. That was written some time ago, never been reevaluated. So we held that. Eucerin, her skin, they reported that her skin was in fine condition. We held that. On 23 milligrams sustained release daily at bedtime. Didn't change that till later on because I wanted to bring that dose down. But that was a concern. She's on one of my least favorite antidepressants, Paxil, but didn't want to suddenly stop that. Olanzapine, 15 milligrams, in one study by the company that makes it, was no better than placebo. So it's constipating, you've got her anticholinergic, she had not had a bowel movement in three or four days. And she was on calcium carbonate as a supplement, stopped that. Docusate, which is great for removing earwax, is totally worthless for constipation. Right, unless, whatever, you had Senna. She was on my least favorite drug, Depakote. We cut that in half. We increased the acetaminophen, took her off the ferrous sulfate. There was no indication that she had an iron deficiency anemia. When I say that, this is all in the consult to the primary medical provider who was right on board. This was not an easy patient to deal with, right? This was a tough situation. And was like, just tell me what to do. And I love to do that. Ativan, lorazepam, again, 1 milligram, way too much. And again, it was not PRN. You look at the medication administration record, she was getting it every day. When that wears off, she's going to have a spike in anxiety. Benzodiazepines tend to do that. They tend to cause anxiety when it wears off. It's not short acting. The onset's going to be about 40 to 45 minutes, and it's going to wear off in about 6 to 8 hours. Probably about 2 to 3 o'clock in the morning, right? Just what you want is a screaming patient in bed at 2 or 3 in the morning. So that's how you become a problem patient. Got rid of the melatonin. Codeine wasn't working, and that's because the Paxil is preventing it from being an effective drug. It prevents the conversion of codeine to morphine, and also because when I looked at the full medical history, she had a history of osteoporosis, and she had spinal cord compression fractures on x-ray. It looked like to me they were clamping down on some nerves probably. So she probably had, and she did have, skeletal muscle pain and neuropathic pain. So now we need to take care of two kinds of pain. And that was what we did. But the first step, again, is getting rid of drugs. Geriatrics has been described as the art of DCing drugs. And oversimplified, but in fact true. Except in the area of depression and pain are the two areas I see undertreated all the time. So we want to get her on efficient, round-the-clock pain medication, something for the neuropathic pain, get a little more sort of oomph to the staff there to be more attentive. The daughter met me there. She spoke to the administrator. She was a lawyer, by the way, about rectifying some of the problems in the facility. So that turned out to be a good intervention that wasn't actually all that complicated. But initially, it was just sundowning. GH, we met earlier, his frontal temporal dementia lobe patient, and he's 59. And the issues here were Aricept kinds of drugs very often make FTD patients worse. They make their behavior worse. These drugs are not only not approved for that, but it's not the right kind of dementia. Ativan, again, was not the correct approach. This patient should be on a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. No good studies. They're all open-label trials, but we do this all the time. So we'll select usually citalopram or Lexapro, sometimes Zoloft, and treat to an effective dose. Trazodone has some evidence at bedtime in fairly large doses, up to, I can't remember the exact, I think it's up to several hundred milligrams a night at bedtime, small study out of France, improved behavior in FTD patients during the day. Okay, wasn't given during the day. So this was a case of DCing some drugs and adding some drugs. And then, of course, as always, behavioral interventions that are being taught to the caregiver. And this is our retired physician. This is a little more complicated. I think, yeah, we will end on time. This is a gentleman that I knew for some years. He actually died eventually. Probably, I can't remember, in a facility, but most of his life was spent at home. He had a very dedicated family, wonderful family, adult children that were very involved. And he wound up on about 400 milligrams, I think, initially, of Seroquel, titrated up slowly over the course of about a month and a half. So we're not talking small doses here, right? We're talking big-time doses, less than you would use in schizophrenia. The Seroquel in Alzheimer's patients, not a lot of studies, but the ones that were effective, usually the effective dose is around 200 milligrams total. And you don't go to that right away. It's slowly increased. If patients respond at 25 BID, which in Alzheimer's would be unusual, but can it happen? That's great. Lewy body patients respond much lower doses, much lower in Lewy body dementia. So we also increased his dose of citalopram to the maximum amount, and pain was not an issue with him. So other secondary problems or psychiatric issues, physical issues, were not a problem. It was strictly Alzheimer's disease, severe assault of aggressive behavior. And in fact, about a month after we got him on a fairly good dose of Seroquel, he struck his wife again. So you think, what do I need to add, right? No. You say, what happened? She said, well, he peed on the floor and I hollered at him. So immediately he turned around. So then my nurses came in that we work with. Sometimes I work with nurses, social counselors, social workers who are counselors. And trained her further. They had already done some training about how not to do that to protect herself. And it never occurred again. I saw him a couple months later in his home, and we had a nice little session of hand wrestling, and he beat me every time. He was about 6'3", about 225 pounds, in very good shape. So those are the cases. These are some references that I have for you, I think, in your outline. I think a lot of the studies that I referred to are there. The research, alzforum.org, is a good site to look at for research information in Alzheimer's. And you can look for there. You may find the recent study in Stanford, someone else did it, of mouse transfusions, right from old young mice to old mice. It's interesting. It'll be years before it comes to fruition if it works out. Drug information, I suggest rxlist.com. It's free. I think it's authoritative, and it's updated frequently. And if I said something or a study, I don't like to go through all the studies that I might allude to or present, but if it's one you're particularly interested in, you can email me, and I'll send you that reference. So if I think we have a couple minutes left. I thought there'd be more questions during the case. But we have a few minutes. I have 10 minutes, right? No? You used up some of my time. I'm not going to. No, I get that time back.
Excuse me. Did I hear you say that Celexa and aspirin would increase ulcers?
Celexa, usually, well, aspirin depends on the dose. Aspirin is always an increased risk for gastric ulcers. Recently, the FDA just recently suggested it not be used for primary prevention, although it still, you know, probably will be. But yes, any of the drugs in the Celexa family, because they affect the, something called the platelets, increase the risk for bruising and possibly bleeding, but they're not, quote, blood thinners like Coumadin, but they could increase the risk for a gastric ulcer. With aspirin, it depends on the dose. So usually the 81 milligrams could do it, but it's unlikely. But it's always, again, risk versus benefit.
I have a question about trazodone.
Mm-hmm.
The side effect list of trazodone is enough to make me not use it or take it. Could you comment on that? It seems to be, you know, used a lot with success in the elderly.
What's a side effect that concerns you?
The length of the list, there's quite a few side effects.
Well, all drugs have side effects. As I mentioned earlier, sugar pills have side mm-hmm. effects.
I mean, it would make me say, want to use a little Ambien or something
else. No, it's much safer than Ambien. Women, we found now that women metabolize Ambien far, far less efficiently than men. And we're seeing it's been documented, but it just recently came out from the FDA, that women in general should receive half the dose as men. Problems driving, doing things they wouldn't ordinarily do. And in my dementia clinics, we're not very keen on Ambien. So the history of sleep meds is interesting. We always go through this love thing in the beginning, and then it turns to love-hate, and then eventually it just goes to hate. Right? You watch it. It happens all the time. It happened with barbiturates. It happened with Quaalude. Anyone remember Quaalude? Yeah. Safer in an overdose. No hangover, safe sleep medication. That's what the rep that first came in to see me told me. How did it turn out? Wrong, right? Bad drug. Yes?
I have a question.
Sure.
I have a question about anxiety in people who also have COPD. I see a lot of Ativan for people with COPD, and I don't know if it's because they're taking inhalers that help.
Well, the inhalers that are used in COPD, some components of that can cause anxiety. What I see most frequently is the adrenergic drugs. What I see most frequently is I look at their caffeine intake. And very often, it's the additive caffeine that kicks it over. And the other reason to be anxious, if you have breathing problems, is you're not breathing well. Right? But caffeine is always something to look for in these patients that are asthmatic or COPD. And it can be in a lot of sources. A lot of your cola drinks, for example. I told you about the size. One of my very early patients taught me that. So she was very anxious, went to the bathroom a lot, had a little GI upset. And I said, well, how many cola drinks do you drink? She said, I drink three a day. I said, three like that? She said, no, three like that. She drank 4.5 liters, right, a day. Never forgotten that. You'll learn. I've learned so much from my patients. I've learned that. And I've learned working in the clinic side by side with physicians, nurses, neuropsychologists, social workers, therapists, that all the things that I've discussed today, which may sound fairly facile, is very, very difficult. It's not easy. What are my thoughts on the use of lithium in elderly patients? It depends on the patient. Lithium is a medication that actually does have naturally occurring product, right? Lithium is. It was used once, start out in Australia, as a substitute for sodium chloride, and they poisoned a few people because it wasn't a good idea to do that. But we do know in bipolar disorders that it's the one agent that reduces the risk for suicide. So in elderly patients, because it's cleared out through the kidney, you have to be very, very careful. And I don't see many of my elderly patients on lithium. It's unusual. It could be there, but it's certainly not common, and there certainly has to be a very good reason. Another question back there? Hi.
Your mic is not on.
Yeah, my hearing is good, but...
Hello. So I had heard recently that when Alzheimer's or other dementia patients are admitted to hospice, that they should, the thinking is now that they should continue on Aricept and or Exelon or Namenda, but I had been told that they were only in place really to keep somebody from getting into long-term care and that they wouldn't really be helping at the point where someone is admitted to hospice. Hospice,
I've worked a lot with hospice programs, especially in our prion study, because these are patients they're not familiar with. When I say a lot, I'm talking about all over the United States and a couple in Europe. Hospice programs, I've worked with them with cancer patients when I was involved in a home care program for 5 years at UCSF, where we took care of a lot of cancer patients at home, managed their drug therapy and so on. And I have I've worked with hospice in managing patients with neurological conditions. My experience is this, and this is my bias, is that in general, they're not as familiar with these neurological conditions as they are in direct pain management. And sometimes that's a problem. And I'm biased because I have that right now. Because the packet of medications they leave, right, for as-needed use, usually includes Ativan, Haldol, can't remember what else, but those are the ones. And the caregiver is giving them PRN to the patient, who is probably shouldn't be in hospice. He doesn't have a terminal illness. Did I answer your question? Okay, repeat it. Repeat it.
My question is, and I have to say I'm totally, well, not totally against Haldol and Ativan, but I think you have to do a really thorough assessment.
At the end of life, they may have a role, yeah.
Well, if you have to do your nursing assessment or your physician assessment to find out, do they have pain or is it a caregiver interaction issue or whatever, just like what you were saying. But my question was, when someone is admitted to hospice, at that point, what does the evidence show about keeping the Aricept or Exelon or Namenda on the med list? Why?
Okay, sounds like your question is, if you go into hospice, should we stop the cholinesterase inhibitor?
Thank you.
Is that the question?
Yes,
thank
much
you.
More direct. Thank
You're
you.
Right. And that's a question that the neurologist or the primary care provider should answer. I don't, in my opinion, think that's something the hospice group should answer because they don't know that patient as well as their primary neurologist or physician or their nurse practitioner. So it would depend on the situation and the patient. And the patient I'm referring to right now is still on a cholinesterase inhibitor. Okay? But the problem is, I think the first thing is, are they really hospice, are they terminal? And I've had terminal neurologic, like Lewy body patients, that were in hospice that we worked with in managing their medications. I've had cortical basal degeneration patient, which I personally worked with in the home with a hospice nurse. Basically, the physician dropped out and left it to us, and we managed her medications. The key to that was the nurse, because then I knew what was going on. So I love hospice, but not necessarily across the board for my neurological patients. Okay? Thank you very much for your attention. Enjoy the rest of the program. It's a pleasure and an honor to join you today.